I remember the teacher called and we listened. We had to memorize quite a lot too. A lot of time was spent filling out books and collecting them up again. We were sitting in rows of desks so we could see the board better, because talk and talk was a way.
There must be an industrial revolution in education, in which educational science and the ingenuity of educational technology combine to model up mostly inefficient, clumsy procedures of conventional education. Sydney El Corte, 1924.
These young people are studying in a new way. A computing calculator designed for use in high school classrooms has created tremendous excitement among educators.
The tool which has made this possible is a high-speed digital computer operating with electronic precision on great quantities of information.
If you think about the third industrial revolution, that was PCs, internet, and we've just about caught up with that. The fourth industrial revolution is what becomes possible from the technologies.
Industry 4.0 is the next big shift in the way that manufacturing operates. Digital know-how is going to be hugely important, and then people will need to be flexible because the world will change.
The future societies we're still moulding them as we go, and technology is one of the main pillars in what this shape looks like.
The paper case with the introduction of the exponential technologies, creating a paradigm shift to create applications for information. The lectures aren't fit for purpose anymore. Using textbooks and teaching in a Victorian sort of method with rows of students and listening to the teacher taking notes. It's obsolete. We need to use our time in lessons to actually have meaningful mentoring one-to-ones that could never be replaced. The technology gives us that time if we use it correctly. Rather than being something that's scary, we can use technology to be something that's very liberating for people, so instead of having to go through the rigmarole of institutional learning as it's been in the past, we can actually use smart robotics, smart computers to make learning more accessible to more people and actually tailor to individual needs.
This whole cluster of AI technologies will make learning for students more rewarding, teaching for academics more rewarding. We want it to be a win for everybody.
We've shown already in clinical studies and trials the retention is up to 70% higher in virtual reality. That has a huge impact on learning and retention of facts.
The challenge is for them to really develop their students' digital skills so they can actually make use of those skills in the workplace.
It would be all too easy to say everyone must learn to code, but the truth is coding is just one digital skill.
Creativity, collaboration, communication, critical thinking. These skills that can never be automated, that can never be replaced, are what we need to focus on.
Education 4.0 is a request to the education sector to rethink education programs. And it's an opportunity for us as this fourth industrial revolution kicks off to think about what modern education should be.
We now live in a hyper-connected world. And now, the time, more than ever, the time is for us to say, what do we want to do with that?
Okay, so welcome to the International Forum of Education, Future of Education in Sri Lanka. Most of you know me in person, but there are people whom I'm meeting for the first time. So my name is Chamin Dekyarachi. I'm a kind of academic as well as an education manager or management professional in education, based in mainly in higher education, based in Colombo, Sri Lanka. Today I'm the moderator for the session, and I'm hosting this along with a few other colleagues. Let me introduce them with their roles. They will talk to you later, but for your communication purposes during the session, let me introduce Milan Fernando, connected from Canada. He's our host of the session. Yeah, and then please don't share the screen, Sindranath. you are sharing the screen. You have to unshare the screen, otherwise you are getting disturbance in our screen. Chandani is connected from Brunei. She's the kind of the integrator or summarizer, and who will also do a report on our session. And we also have Dayal. Where's Dayal? You can say hi. Where's Dayal from Colombo? Okay, so Dayal will be like our integrator or kind of a provoker who will ask questions and add contributions based on what is relevant and what is maybe not relevant during particularly during the discussion. And also Chandani and Dayal will be doing the Q&A session using chat functions. So if you have any questions, if you want to say something, you create discussion, they will be kind of moderating that. All right, but they will talk to you later and introduce themselves. Now, first of all, let me introduce to discuss about the objectives of goals of this this program, because I found a lot of people are not familiar with this forum or this format, where people like to have or they expect standard or traditional seminars or conference, but we are doing slightly different way. So I want to just highlight what we are trying to do. Now, first objective is to, we want to create a platform for diversified people of, you know, of interest, from senior academics to policymakers to normal people like us who are interested. Not, maybe are not very much expert of the subject, but we want to also have our say here. So we want to create a forum for them to discuss, debate, and deliberate ideas about future of education. And also, in addition to that, we want to make this as like online market place where people can come and do window shopping or buy ideas, sell ideas, and create other, you know, interested things like in any market, online marketplace. Finally, most important thing is which I have already discussed today, or I shared a post also on that. So this is a typical a platform of wisdom of the crowd. So of course we have a lot of experts, very highly achieved people academically, but we want to drive the, you know, idea of shared ideas by many are more important or more relevant than few experts taking decisions together. So that's the underlying kind of drive we are trying to do. We want everybody to participate. We want more people. Of course, this is logistically difficult. There will be noises, connecting issues, a lot of other disturbance. But we want to have many people join, not necessarily only like very important people. Of course, we are important people, but the idea is this is a collaborative brainstorming session or peer-to-peer brainstorming session. And if I use design thinking terminology, even this is brainstorming, it's more like divergent thoughts. So we want divergent ideas coming without any hesitation or any reluctance of sharing. Now, we have already mentioned, but I will highlight again, our preferred language is English, because then it can reach to many people, because we will be recording this and sharing in other forums on YouTube and other online forums. But you are free to speak in Tamil or Sinhala, in German, or any other language of your choice. You don't have to worry about it, but you should know its limitation, that you cannot be able to create a larger discussion. But if you don't do that, that is also fine. All right, so these are the main objectives. Any questions you can type, then I can answer later. Now, when we were trying to discuss about the topic, a lot of people said we should think about education reform. But our approach is again the content or the focus is slightly different. We want to look at future of education. So there can be, of course, in Sri Lanka, there are a lot of discussions about education reforms, how it should go ahead. And there has been many attempt to reform. So, but we want to keep all these options open, all these as valid subject matter, but we want to give a new dimension about where we want to be and how we want to go there in a futuristic approach. But it doesn't mean that the historical experience or current attempts and practical problems we are facing are not relevant, but they are important. But I want to highlight, at least in my perspective, how we should kind of plan or envision education for the future purposes. I want to, when I was kind of working on this, I came up with this very nicely done educational, how can I say, country policy or vision of Sri Lanka. I'm sure whether you have done this, like read this, but it's called, it's like the government policy of it's Gotabaya Rajapaksa's government of policy, which is kind of being implemented. I don't know how successful it is, but that is a formal document which you can download from National Education Commission website. Now, as you can see, this is the typical, you can raise your hand if you have seen this or participated. This is very highly, you know, there's a big group behind that. A lot of known people. It is, you have hand raise function, right? Please use it. If you want to say that if you have contributed or if you have seen that or referred this, it is actually a 229-page document with lot of details, lot of ideas. But this is, again, it's a typical Sri Lankan way of taking national policies, policies by having a closed-door consultancy approach by, high, relevant people, or high-profile people. Now, there's also summary of that. I think this is what they presented to President. This is about 26 page. I am saying this is a good effort, very good, important ideas, but it has the limitation what I mentioned to you. You don't have to go into details, but if you look at how they have recommended, you can see general education, technical vocational education, higher education, and nursing education. So they have added something like, I would say it's a political maybe purpose, nursing education as a separate segment. And if you read this, it is about how you do some evolutionary changes to the existing education. They have talked about some concepts, but in actual sense, when they discuss about activities and all these things, they are saying, okay, this should be improved, this should kind of implemented, but there's no kind of breakthrough thinking in this document, at least. If you know this about this one, we can discuss and debate later. So I'm saying again, it is a good one. It is the available commercial valid one, but it has a limitation of the people thinking about current education and maybe some marginal improvements, but it's not really what we are considering as future of education. Okay, so this is anyway the formal document of Sri Lankan government as we see now. But now what I am looking at is, when I say future of education, this is only my idea, so we have no purpose to convert you or disagree with other people, but I want others to openly discuss the ideas. But for me now, for example, when you talk about future education, you have to look at what is happening outside education domain. So for example, Industry 4 is changing everything. I am not going to talk about Industry 4 with you. I assume that you know that it's the new revolution happening in the physical, digital, as well as biological domains, and blurring of traditional boundaries. So it is forcing and it is disrupting entire human life, even who humans are. As a result of that, and also in addition to that new situation of COVID, by combining this digital revolution, so it is, they are redefining the idea of work and jobs and even skill development. So that means it has direct impact on what we mean by education. So the video I showed you earlier is about education 4.0, how education should be compatible with the Industry 4 revolution. Very quickly, I will not spend a lot of time about sharing my ideas, but just to have some kind of similar understanding about what we are talking. Let me quickly share another maybe no, I'll share the other one first. Oh, I made a mistake there. Okay, let me just look at this one. Okay, so this now, for example, if you look at this article, you don't have to look at that in detail, but I just want to highlight you now. OECD countries are looking at education, for example, for the future. They have kind of they have predicted, or they have forecasted in different ways. Now, in terms of skills required, they have categorized them as fundamental literacy, which normally we are talking here at the moment in Sri Lanka mainly literacy, numeracy, scientific literacy, ICT literacy, financial literacy, cultural and civic literacy. I think we are also looking mainly about that as required educational skills. But also then we have to look at competencies, critical thinking, problem solving, creativity, communication and collaboration. I'm not very sure whether we have developed our system to be compatible with those competencies. And then we also have character qualities, curiosity, initiative, persistence, adaptability, leadership, social and cultural awareness. Those things, I don't know how we have accommodated to our education system. I'm talking about not only just education in school level, but also in all levels. So therefore, according to UNESCO, we need a democratization of science education. This is mainly about STEM education. And so this is one thing I want to highlight, but the other one is the one which is very relevant to us. Let me just talk about, I will have to open it. Yeah, open again. Okay, this one, I think is also relevant to developing countries, including Sri Lanka, mainly like the idea is what will be the education, how will education look like after 20 years. This is done in 2020, yeah, 21. So now this is also World Economic Forum kind of prediction. They are looking at the possible four scenarios in the, about schooling. One is we will have extended schooling, more number of years people are going to schooling, or education outsourced, maybe not that, but a lot of countries and a lot of societies will outsource so-called traditional schooling system. Third possible scenario is schools as learning hub. That is also a possibility. And final one, which we sometimes see nowadays, learning as you go. For example, it's not formal education, but different ways of other learn as you go approach. All these need rethinking, rewiring, and re-envisioning of what we think and what we do as education. A final point, now this is something I want you to have discussion today. Now, when we look at how our education should be in the future and what we have now, so there should be some kind of balance between our way of modernizing our reforms and managing the disruption of the existing system. Now, how we reconcile those requirements, as I have shown you in the future, and with our existing structures, maybe school system, universities, and what we mean by education and such other structures. I think the purpose is how to have globally minded people, but locally rooted students and teachers. There are other questions. I will not go into detail due to lack of time. But most important thing is who should drive education. That's the important thing. Most of the discussion in Sri Lanka are, as I told you, are top to bottom or expert driven. All the discussions we have, all the policy reforms. So, but now, as I mentioned to you, consultative approach with all the stakeholders, more democratization education is something which is not really, I would say, is happening. That is why we want to have these kind of debates and discussions. And what about the education of most vulnerable groups? I think we have discussion, particularly during this COVID time. So these are some of the discussion globally happening. So I think some of these are very relevant to us during our next few hours of the discussion. I think we should deliberate on deliberately look at these ideas as a group. Okay, so that's my contribution. Since I have been involved in Sri Lankan education, also I have also I'm familiar with a few education models like Sri Lankan, British, German, and American model. I am not going to post my ideas. I want you to share your ideas freely and openly and honestly. Now, before going to your discussion, I want to also set some ground rules in our forum. As I already mentioned, English is preferred, but you are free to discuss without any hesitation in your own language of choice. And we need to have diversified ideas, not on agreement, but lot of maybe can be disagreement, but we should try to focus structurally. Like, for example, are you talking about school education, university education, professional education, or informal education, or whatever you call it? So maybe you can refer that one also. And then now, as I mentioned to you, even though the name is Future of Education, and I as a person, I'm more interested in starting from the future and try to go develop strategy to go there. But maybe some of you think start from what we have now or what we have experienced in the past and develop from there. So that can be also approach. So you can talk about past experience. You have done your own projects and some tests in Sri Lankan education system at all levels. Now we have a very high level of internationalization here. So we also appreciate not only Sri Lankan examples, but examples from other countries, your own country or any system familiar to you, please you can share them with us today. Now, due to the large number, we are expecting more people to join. So everybody will have, in the first round, 5 minutes to share your ideas, introduce yourself, maybe your name, where you're connected from, and your connection to you know, the education, like academic or researcher or whatever you like to call yourself. And then in the next round, we'll have the second level discussions about the issues and the knowledge gathered during the first round. And we will have, as a result of that, now again, I want to highlight to again, we have no predefined outcome. We don't want to drive this group to something we want. So we want that also to come as a result of the discussion. So what we are going to do is have a report on this meeting and also facilitate this discussion to go for additional discussion on the same topic. But it doesn't mean that you have to go with our way of work. Some people are very much in a hurry to have implementing projects. So you are free to have your own group and go with them. The final point, 2 points. One is, now we said already, we will have first join, first speak principal, but we have a few people who have requested to come at the beginning. So I have 2-3 guys to have that privilege, but other than that, we will go with as we join. Now, this one, the final thing I want to say, this may be familiar to you, but I want to, for the record, I want to repeat again. This is called Chatham House Rule. That means academics know this, and we all are, we are here to freely express our ideas. You can get ideas from this group and share it somewhere else, but Chatham House Rule applies. That means you can't quote other people saying, like, Chamin Dhetya, to say something against President Rajapaksa. You can't do like that. It's not ethical. This is, of course, you know, if you are a high educational professional. So, but it applies as a principle. Okay, that's all I have to say. I would invite Milan to continue, and maybe if I forgot something, you can go ahead.
Yeah, I am muted. Yeah. Yes, thank you, Chaminda. Thank you, everyone. My name is Nilan Fernando, graduated from Sri Lanka, University of Kalaniya.